What's up, guys? It's your favorite Kiwi coach. Today, we're going to be talking about the Sam Snead squat. Let's go do this thing. All right, guys, line item number one. Why do we want to do the Sam Snead squat? Well, simply put, it gives us more vertical ground force. Now, with more vertical ground force, we're going to get more club head speed. So how do we get vertical ground force? Well, the easiest way to get it, the most efficient way, is we want to get the most pressure into the lead side without moving linear, okay? So again, the most pressure you can get into the lead side without moving as much linear is going to be how you get vertical ground force. Now, with the Sam Snead squat, as you can see what I just did, we're getting the left side pelvis to lower and we're getting a lot of pressure into the lead side, but notice how the pelvis bone isn't going linear, okay? So again, that's why we got to go into it. So now that we understand that, let's get into the micro moves of the Sam Snead squat. So the first part we're gonna go into is gonna be the knees, okay? So I got some golf balls laid out here. This is gonna be our clock system. So this golf ball right here is gonna be 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3, 12 o'clock, 11 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 9. Same thing with these golf balls, 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3, 12 o'clock, 11 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 9. Okay, so let me kind of go into first what you guys typically go wrong with this. So as we swing up to the top of the swing, I'm gonna see a lot of you guys get the trail side knee working too far in external rotation. It's gonna look like this. Now notice how my kneecap is pointing right around 3 o'clock, as well as my kneecap is outside the trail side foot. Now the reason why we don't like that is, the first reason is because we're gonna get too much pressure outside the instep, okay? So if you get too much pressure outside the instep, we're gonna have a hard time shifting pressure forward, so we're not gonna get our vertical ground force. Second part as well is, some players who get too much pressure outside are going to push too far linear in transition, and then we're also not going to get the optimum amount of vertical ground force. Okay, so let me show you guys exactly how it should look. So as we swing up to the top of the swing, the trail side knee is going to slowly work external to right around 1 o'clock at left arm parallel. Now once we get down to hands level to hips, we're going to see the trail side knee at 12 o'clock, and then we're also going to see the lead side knee over right around 10 o'clock to 9 o'clock. Now from here, we're gonna start seeing the trail side knee work internal, 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 as the lead side knee works external, external, external. Now from this position as well, you're gonna start seeing both knees start extending. And then once we get to the follow through, we're gonna have the knees kissing, okay? So again, this is exactly how the knees are gonna work. And this is very important, or else you guys are gonna start messing around with pressure, low point, and some other things like that. All right, guys, so the next part of the swing we're gonna focus in on is the pelvis. So where I typically see you guys go wrong is, as we swing up to the top of the swing, I'm gonna see the lead side pelvis extending. Now the reason why we don't like the lead side pelvis extending is because the chest won't be able to rotate efficiently through the golf ball. When the chest doesn't rotate efficiently, the body stalls out at the bottom of the swing, the arms take over. So now what I would recommend instead is, let's swing up to the top of the swing. We're gonna get the lead side pelvis lowering in transition. Now, this is kind of a hard concept for you guys to grasp, so this is the best success I've had with my students, and let's go over it. So I get my students to cross their arms. Let's get the lead side body lower than the trail side body. Now notice how that gets the lead side pelvis lower than the trail side. Now from here, the issue we have with this is that the sternum is now in front of the pelvis. So to fix this, let's just add on a little bit of right bend. Now notice how that gets the ratio between this pelvis and the sternum in its correct place. Now from here, let's start talking about the rest of the downswing with the pelvis. So again, as we said, swing up to the top and stop, get that lead side pelvis lowering in transition. Now once we get level with the hips, from here we're gonna start seeing that the lead side pelvis is slightly lower than the trail side pelvis. Now from here, once we get down into impact, we're gonna start seeing the lead side pelvis slightly higher than the trail side pelvis. Now once we get hands level to hips, same type of thing, we're going to see the lead side pelvis slightly higher than the trail side pelvis. And then once we get all the way through the finish and our knees are kissing, we're going to see this pelvis level off. Now from here, let's start talking about the axis of the shoulders and how that works out. Alright guys, so now let's start talking about how the axis of the shoulders should work. So let's go over the common mistakes I see first. So the first motion I typically see is, we're going to see the over-the-top slicer get this lead side shoulder drastically lowering and then pretty much staying there throughout the whole swing. And that's gonna be your over the top steep slicer. Now from there, the second motion I typically see, from the top of the swing, we're gonna see the trail side shoulder drastically lower than the lead side shoulder, and that's gonna get swing direction too far out to the right. You're gonna stall out and flip, okay? So let's talk about exactly how the axis of the shoulder should work. So as we get up to the top of the swing, we're gonna start seeing the trail side shoulder slowly lowering, and by hands level to hips, we're gonna see it pretty level, okay? So the trail side shoulder and the lead side shoulder are gonna be fairly level at this point, dependent on club as well. Now from here, once we get into impact, we're gonna start seeing the trail side lower shoulder lower, 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 lower. And now at impact, we definitely have the trail side shoulder lower than the lead side shoulder. Now from here, we're gonna start seeing the shoulders shift off again. So from here, we're gonna start seeing the trail side shoulder lower. And then once the hands get level to hips, they're gonna start leveling out again. Then from the top of the swing and your finish, you're gonna see the axis of the shoulders level, okay? So this is very crucial, because if you have the pelvis working correctly, you have the knees working correctly, but the shoulders don't work correctly, you're gonna be out of sync, okay? So we gotta have all three of these categories working together in sequence for you guys to fully utilize the Sam Snead squat. All right, guys, so hopefully you guys enjoyed that video on the Sam Snead squat. Feel free to smash that like button, leave a comment, let me know how I'm doing. Also as well, subscribe to my channel if you guys feel like I'm bringing value. I try to give golf tips weekly, hopefully on the daily here pretty soon. So anyways, guys, hopefully you guys are out there practicing, grinding, and have a good one.